Good morning, students. In today's class, we will discuss about photometry. So, in which colorimetry and spectrophotometry. So, these topics we already discussed. This is like a revision. Okay. So, we will discuss these topics under introduction, laws of photometries, absorption transmittance, absorption of maxima, and the instrumentation of photometry, parts of photometer and types of photometry like colorimetry and spectrophotometry, and the principles, operations and applications. Okay, so photometry. So the name suggests, photo means light, metry means measurement. Okay, so photometry means measurement of light. So it measures the intensity of absorbed, transmitted or reflected light. So when a light passes through a solution, it may be absorbed or transmitted in through the solution or reflected back like mirror. Okay, that is related to the concentration of test substance. So it is the most commonly used analytical technique in the laboratory, like spectrophotometry, colorimetry we use, spectrophotometry we use, and reflectance spectrophotometry we use, flame photometry we use, and atomic absorption spectrophotometry. So these are all commander photometry only. Okay, so based on the common principle of photometry only, all these instruments will work. Photometer is a tool. So metry is a measurement. Photometer is a tool or instrument used to determine the concentration of compounds which are present in the solution by measuring the electromagnetic radiation. Okay, so this electromagnetic radiation means like light. It may contain visible light and ultraviolet radiation and infrared radiation also. So all together we call as here electromagnetic radiation. So come to the colorimetry. So this is the color we measuring. So colorimetry, colorimetry, that is a measurement of intensity of color in a solution. There is a colorimeter. It is an instrument used to measure the concentration of compounds which is present in the solution by measuring the visible light. So here can say only visible light only we can measure in colorimetry. So when we say we measuring the intensity of light, so electromagnetic radiation. Okay, so electromagnetic radiation which is propagates or pass like a wave like manner. So this is a wave like manner. So we call as the distance between the two peaks, this one peak and this one another peak, between two peaks we call as wavelength. So the wavelength of the light is defined as the distance between two peaks or crests. Okay, as light travels in a wave-like manner, because so light is a part of electromagnetic radiation. So this distance, the wavelength, we usually express it as nanometers. So these nanometers we usually use in calorimeters, like 680 nanometer, 700 nanometer, like that. So other than nanometers, sometimes they will use millimicrons. That is 1 millimicron is a nanometer. That is, and so 10 angstroms equal to 1 millimicron or 1 nanometer, and it is equal to 10 to the power of 9 meters. So 1 nanometer is a 10 to the power of 9 meters, minus 9 meters. So electromagnetic radiation includes radiant energy that extends from cosmic rays with a wavelength as short as 10 nanometer or less than 10 nanometer up to radio waves, which is longer than 100 kilometers. This is that much length. So the term light is used to describe the radiant energy from the ultraviolet light and visible portion of spectrum, which covers the 180 to 800 nanometer of electromagnetic radiation. You will see here, you can see the electromagnetic spectrum. So here, so 10 to the power of 12 minus 12 meters to 10 to the power of 3 meters. So more than 10 to the power of 3 meters also it is there, like more than kilometer here. Here 10 to the power of 9, that is the nanometers. Okay. So here only that specific very less, that is 800 nanometer up to 800 nanometer, that is a visible range. Okay, so more than that it is a infrared, whereas less than 250 here, that is ultraviolet rays. So visible light is a only very small portion of electromagnetic spectrum. Here so frequency and energy are directly proportional. Okay, if the less frequency, so more energy here, and energy are directly proportional, whereas frequency and wavelength are inversely proportional. If the frequency increases, wavelength will be decreases. Here frequency means that light passes through the point of and the point in the time. So the waves which pass through the those point within a time, that is a frequency. Here the visible light, it is a narrow range of electromagnetic waves with a wavelength of 400 to 700 nanometer. Within the 400 to 700 or 380 nanometers, exactly if you say 380 to 750 nanometers, that is a visible light. So 700 nanometer, that is red in color, whereas blue light, that is 400 nanometer or 380 nanometer, less than 400 nanometer, that is ultraviolet range. So less than this violet region, ultraviolet, less than 400, whereas more than 700, that is infrared. Okay, more than 700, that is infrared, near to there. So if you want to remember the those colors, there is a mnemonic, that is VIBGR: violet, indigo, blue, green, yellow, orange and red. This is the order of colors. So you can see, so less than 380 nanometers or 400, that is ultraviolet rays, that is invisible, we cannot see. And from 380 to 750 or 700 nanometers, that is a visible range, that only color we can see. Okay, so 380 to 440, that is a violet color, whereas 440 to 500 blue color, and 500 to 580 green color, 580 to 600 yellow, and 600 to 620 orange, and 620 to 750 is a red color. So more than 750 we call as infrared. Okay, which is also not visible, only small region, that is 380 to 750 nanometer region of electromagnetic radiation only we can see, that is we call as light here. Okay, so color wheel here, complementary colors lies across the diameter and the color wheel. So combining these two color, that is complement, if the this one blue color, that is the opposite color here, that is yellowish to red, the complementary color. If the two colors we combining, that is will to form the white color, white light. So the color of compound seen by eye is complement of color of light absorbed by the color compound. So that is completes the color. So this is the same principle we use it to, so complementary colors we use it to get the maximum absorbance when measuring the in solutions, measuring solutions in a colorimeter or spectrophotometers. Here you can see when the light pass through the solution, this is the cuvette which containing color solution with the path length, that is a path length means the way the through the light passes, how much distance it travels within the cuvette. Here is the light passing from the here to here, that is a, this is the incident light which is the starting light, and after passing through the solution some of the light is absorbed or transmitted or reflected. Reflect means reflect back, absorbed, or some of it is transmitted. This is the transmitted light. If the concentration increases, the light absorption also increases. Okay, and definitely the transmitted light will be decreased. So this is the path length, that is a this one from here to here, there is a path length. Okay, so this one you remember, we will discuss again in the absorbance and transmittance. So come to the absorbance and transmittance, these terms usually we will discuss in or we regularly use it in measuring calorimeters, how much is absorbed or transmitted. Mainly absorbance is mainly used. So what do you mean by absorbance? So the amount of light absorbed is termed as absorbance. Here A or optical density of the that compound. So a measure of capacity of substance to absorb the light of specific wavelength. So A is equal to E into I into C. So A is the amount of light absorbed which is depend on molar absorptivity and distance of light traveled and concentration. So molar absorptivity we will discuss, and distance of light traveled, the distance of light traveled is more, absorbance also more, and concentration of solute which is present in the solution is more, and absorbance also more. So absorbance is directly proportional to the concentration and the distance of light traveled in the solution. So transmittance, so what do you mean by transmittance? The amount of incident light, that is the starting light energy that successfully passes through the or transmitted through the glass or other materials and scatters or reflect, that is the transmittance. So T equal to intensity of light emerging, that is I, by intensity of light, that is incident light, that is the I naught. So T is equal to I by I naught. If the concentration of substance increased linearly, transmitted decreases exponentially. Okay, if the concentration increases and the transmittance will be decreased, but this one decreased will be exponentially, whereas and transmitted usually expressed in a range of 0 to 100%. If the 100% transmittance will be there, there is no zero absorbance. Okay, so percentage of transmittance equal to I by I naught into 100. So optical density, the absorbance or OD equal to minus log of 1 into 1 by 1 naught, that is a ratio. So if the percentage transmittance we use, say absorbance is 2 minus log I naught by I zero, that is minus 2 log transmittance. Okay. So absorbance maxima. Here maximum absorbance, that is absorption maxima means maximum absorbance. So the wavelength at which the substance show maximum absorbance, we call as absorbance maxima. So that's why when you measuring the in a colorimeter, we select the certain wavelength for certain compounds. Okay, so that's why, so at that wavelength the absorbance is more or maximum absorbance, that's why we will select the those wavelengths. So come to the emission. So this word we usually seen in flame photometers. So when unatomic absorption spectrophotometers, so when electrons are in a pass through the flame, they will excited from ground state. And so when the excited state, those electrons will come to the ground state, they will emit the light. So this property of electron we called as emission. So come to the molar absorptivity. So molar absorptivity means it is the value of absorptivity when the path length is 1 centimeter. Okay, so all cuvettes are using usually 1 centimeter and concentration expressed in moles per liter, that is molar absorptivity. Okay, the value of molar absorptivity is constant for a given compound at a given wavelength under prescribed condition of solvent, temperature and pH. So molar absorptive value is useful in characterizing compounds and their purity. So based on molar absorptivity, that is when we dilute or make it dissolve 1 molar solvent or compound in a liter of solution, when we measuring in a 1 centimeter path length and the temperature and the pH, specific pH, it may be like 7.07 neutral pH or any pH less than pH. So that molar absorptivity is constant based on the condition of solvent and temperature and pH, which is used to the characterize the compounds and their purity. Okay, so chromophore. So chromophore is a functional group that absorb the light. Like most unsaturated bonds, which is present like double bonds, triple bond and peptide bonds and aromatic compounds, those will absorb the light. Here like double bond, triple bond, peptide bonds and aromatic compounds will absorb the UV light. So based on these we'll measure the some compounds in spectrophotometry like NADHs and proteins, nucleic acids, they contain double bonds and those will absorb certain wavelengths like 260 nanometer and 280 nanometers. So that property we call as chromophore. So we all discussed photometry means measurement of light. So it may be absorbed, transmitted or reflected. Here mainly we measure the absorptivity of the compound. So the light absorption by the compound must obey the Beer's and Lambert's law. Okay, so what is the principle of Beer's Lambert's law? Means here when a beam of monochromatic light pass through a color solution, color substance absorb a portion of light, not the entire light, portion of light, and the remaining light is transmitted. okay. So absorption of light is related to the color intensity. If the more color intensity, the more absorbance of light is there. So which is directly proportional to the concentration of chemical responsible for producing the color. So come to the laws of photometry. The absorption of light by any absorbing substance is governed by the two laws. One is Beard's law and another one is Lambert's law. So what is the Beard's law? When a ray of monochromatic light, parallel beam of light pass through a absorbing medium. Here absorbing medium like solution, color solution. Absorbed medium, amount of light absorbed by a color solution is directly proportional to the concentration of solution. Then A directly proportional to the C, that is absorbance directly proportional to the concentration. And another one is Lambert's law. So what the Lambert's law says? When a ray of monochromatic light, parallel beam of light pass through a absorbing medium, amount of light absorbed, that is A by a color solution, is directly proportional to the path length. Okay, so through which light pass through the solution, that is then absorption directly proportional to the path length. So come to the Beard-Lambert's law. By combining these two laws, we will measure the concentration. We need concentration. Okay, so when a ray of monochromatic light, monochromatic parallel beam of light, monochromatic parallel beam of light pass through an absorbing medium, amount of light absorbed, that is A by color solution, is directly proportional to the concentration of solution and the path length of through which light passes in the solution. So absorption directly proportional to the concentration and light, sorry, path length here. So hence, if the path length kept constant and absorbance or optical density is directly proportional to the concentration of sample. Here, the path length will kept constant, that is 1 centimeter in length. Here, if the optical density of solution is known, the concentration of unknown sample test solution can be calculated from the optical density. So how we calculated means, so concentration of unknown substance calculated by comparison of its absorbance or OD with the absorbance of known concentration, that is standard. So let's A1 and C1 be the absorbance and concentration of test solution. So A1 is the concentration absorbance of test solution and C1 is the concentration of test solution. Okay. And A2 and C2 is the absorbance of concentration of standard solution. So A2 is the absorbance of standard solution and C2 is the concentration of standard solution. So here standard solution, we know the concentration, how much is present. If the glucose used as a standard, we prepare the standard solution like 100 milligrams per deciliter. Okay, so by taking the standard OD, we'll comparing with unknown solution like test solution, like sample. We're measuring the concentration of test solution. So when all the photometric measurements are taken using the cuvettes having sample length 1, then so A1 equal to C1 into path length and A2 equal to C2 and L. So here L is the path length, that is we kept constant 1. So we will need only that concentrations and path length. Here C1, that is the concentration of unknown, and C2 is the concentration of standard, whereas A1 is the absorbance of unknown solution, absorbance of unknown solution, that is the test solution or sample, and A2 is the concentration of known standard. So for requiring C1, we will multiply the concentration of standard with, that is the OD of A1, that is the test solution, by the OD of A2, that is standard solution. So based on this, we measure the concentration of unknown substance by the calculator by concentration of test solution equal to OD of test solution by the OD of standard solution into concentration of standard solution. Now, sometimes we should use the blank, like water blanks, reagent blank, sample blank, and air blank. So blank is run similarly to by treating this simultaneously as the same volume of distilled water or norm saline, that is water blank, wherein the concentration is zero. Okay, so why blank needed means, blank is essential because of the fact that some color comes from reagent itself, like bilirubin reagent is, it will get some color is there. So we don't need that color. So in addition to the color produced by the substance which is to be estimated, only the color which is obtained from the substance only we needed, that only we wanted to measure. So unknown extra color which is produced by the reagent we don't need. That's why we use the reagent blank here. Okay, so the OD value of blank obtained must be subtracted, means or minus, from the OD value of the test and standard to get the true OD values. So then the calculation will be, so concentration of test solution is equal to OD of test minus OD of blank by OD of standard minus OD of blank into concentration of standard solution. So come to the limitations of Beer-Lambert's law. Light must be of narrow wavelength range and preferably monochromatic light. So in colorimetry we can measure only visible range, that is 380 to 750 nanometer in length. That is a very narrow wavelength when compared to electromagnetic spectrum, in which only one type of light, that is one type of nanometer we use to measure, like colorimeter, like in this one, preferably monochromatic. So one color we use. So for these monochromatic, we use like a monochromators, like filters. Okay, so the wavelength of light used should be at the absorption maximum of the solution. This also gives the great sensitivity, because we already discussed absorption maxima. At the specific wavelength, the absorption maximum is more. So the wavelength of light used should be at the absorption maximum of the solution, and there must be no ionization, there is no association or dissociation of solvents of the solute with the concentration or the time, like in measuring enzymes, we cannot measure in calorimetry because there is a concentration difference will be there due to the time decrease or increase in kinetic assays. So the solution is too concentrated, giving an intense color. So the law holds good only up to a threshold maximum concentration. So for a given substances, so that we can rectify it by using dilution of solutions. Okay, so come to the instrumentation of photometry. So common the instrumentation is light source which is required, so here, and slit to produce the ray of light, and monochromate to select, and slit again to select the certain portion of light, and cuvettes which holds the sample and detectors detect the light and displays in the meters like galvanometers. So first one, the light source. It may be a tungsten lamp or halogen lamp or xenon lamp. So light sources should meet the following conditions. It should provide sufficient radiant energy over required wavelength region. Okay. And provide stable output power during the course of measurement. That's why we usually ask, we should on the instrument before half an hour. Why? Because in order to get the stable power for measurement, we have to wait to adjust that power by the light source and supply continuous radiation over the entire wavelength and should be free from any fluctuations. So what are the light sources are? Hydrogen discharge lamp, deuterium lamp and xenon discharge lamp and mercury arc lamps. Those lamps used in UV light like in spectrophotometers, wherein visible light like in colorimeters we use tungsten filament lamp or tungsten halogen lamp, and carbon arc lamps are used in visible light source. Okay, so these differences you'll remember when you're writing calorimetry and spectrophotometry individuals. So come to the monochromators. So monochromators are, we'll select only one type of light, like in photometers filters are used, color filters and interference filters, whereas in spectrophotometers they use prisms or diffraction gratings. So what is the function of filters? So filters provide the desired monochromatic light. So in a wavelength of 380 to 700 nanometer, there is a different colors like violet, indigo, green, blue, orange, red is there, but we require only specific wavelength or specific color, because to get the maximum absorbance we should select the complementary colors. So filters provide the desired monochromatic light, single color monochromatic light, by filtering other wavelengths. So selection filters, like color of filters complement to the color of the solution. This allows only appropriate wavelength of light pass through the color solution to obtain the maximum absorbance. So here you can see color of the solution, filter we used based on that color solution and the wavelength range. From bluish green we use red color filter, which is wavelength at 650 to 700 nanometer. The green blue color solution we use orange color, that is 600 to 650 nanometer. Blue we have to use yellow filter, that is 575 to 600 nanometer. There is violet, we use yellow green filter, that is 555 nanometer to 575. And in the purple color of the solution we get in quantity estimations, we use a green filter. Likewise for red, blue, green, orange, green, blue, yellow, blue and yellowish blue is use violet color filters. There are two types of filters are there, like absorption filters and interference filters. So absorption filters means they work by selective absorptions, which are made up of glass and contain chemical dyes that absorbs all radiance, means all other colors except the desired, which can be passed through that absorption filter. So color absorbed is complement of color of filter. Okay, so interference filters means there is a narrower bandwidth of about 15 nanometer in length and consists of two parallel glass plates and silver internally separated by the thin film of dielectric material, example like cryolite. so which will interference of light waves eliminated under undesired radiation. So only specific wavelength can be passed through the those interference filters. So prisms and diffraction gratings are used in spectrophotometers. So there is a non-linear dispersion of shorter wavelength and dispersion to the greater degree than the longer wavelength. So these prisms are made up of glass, quartz or fused silica. So glass, which is used in color meters, whereas quartz, fused silica are ultraviolet for use for ultraviolet reason. So white light pass through the prism, which will disperse into polychromatic like rainbow, okay, different colors. So rotation of prism to pass the require the wavelength through exit slit, which contains the specific color, which is the required color. So come to the diffraction gratings. So these are used in spectrophotometers and auto analyzers. So large number of parallel lines like grooves, which is ruled on the highly polished surface such as alumina, which is done with a suitable shape diamond tool. For UV or visible region, about 15,000 to 3,000 lines per square inch are drawn, and incident light drifted over the range of angles like grooves act as a scattering center. So when the light strike these grooves or lines, it will refract into the different color, different nanometers. So identical grooves are exactly parallel, which is equally spaced over the length of the grating, which is 3 to 10 centimeters in length. So those grooves made reflective by coating surface with alumina, gold or platinum. So come to the cuvettes. So when the light passes through the monochromator, it will enter this through the slit, and it will pass through the color solution. So the color solution usually used in cuvettes, which contain the color solution. So it may be made up of glass, plastic and quartz. So glass and plastic used for visible light, whereas cuvettes used for UV light, like in spectrophotometers. So cuvettes are used to hold the sample. Those shape may be rectangular or cylindrical in shape. So thickness is 1 cm. Why 1 cm here? Because we kept the path length kept constant, means here 1 cm path length will kept in order to get the concentration or OD. Next, and the cells transmitted in the wavelength region being measured. So come to the detectors. Those detectors are mainly photomultiplier tubes or barrier layers. Here, so these detectors detect the light intensity by converting light signal into the electrical signal. Here, photomultiplier tubes, which are used in the auto analyzers, when the light strike these photomultiplier tubes, it will multiply those light and increase the intensity. So whereas in barrier layer cells, when the light transmitting layer of metal that serves as a collector of electrodes, and the semiconducting layer of copper which oxidizes the or selenium, and a plate of copper or iron. So when light strike these barrier layer cells like collector electrode or semiconductor layer of copper oxide or selenium or plate of copper or iron, which is sends those electrons and converted to the electrical signals. And photodiodes. So these are the semiconductors which change their charged voltage upon being struck by the light. So when light strike these photodiodes, will change their charged voltage. So voltage change is converted to the current, and which is measured, which is displayed in the galvanometer. So it is composed of hundreds of thin semiconductors spaced very close to the together. So each position on the one diode on the diode is calibrated to correspond to a specific wavelength. So each diode is scanned and the resultant electronic change is calculated to be proportional to the absorption. So entire spectrum is recorded within very milliseconds. So signals from the these detectors is proportional to the intensity of light incident on the detector. So after amplification in photometric player tubes and is displayed as a percentage transmittance or as a absorbance. So measuring devices. So after multiplication of these are converting light to the electrical signals. So thus photodetectors response can measure by any of the following readout devices like galvanometers, recorders or emitters and digital readouts. Or so the signal may be transmitted to the computer or a printout device which print the result. So working mechanism of photometers. The source of light like tungsten lamp, the light from the those lamps pass through the an adjustable slit which is followed by a condenser light, condenser lens. This gives a parallel beam of light. When we read about the principle Beer-Lambert's law, we use this word. So this gives a parallel beam of light which then pass through a filter to give a monochromatic light. So monochromatic light then pass through a compartment in which the color solution is placed in a cuvette. So the color solution absorbs some light and the residual or remaining light falls on the detector. That is the incident light, emerging light. So detectors are photosensitive elements which convert light into electrical signal. So electrical signals are generated or quantitated by readout like a galvanometer and read as a optical density, that is absorbance values. And galvanometer is calibrated in percentage transmittance and absorbance. This is the working mechanism of photometries. This can be, we can write for calorimetry and spectrophotometry. Okay, so come to the calorimetry. So the calorimetry is a filter photometer that measures the color concentration of substance in solution. So principle is same for photometers and spectrophotometers. Okay, so same principle you should write for calorimeter also. So the color is, this is accomplished by the electrochemically by detecting the color of light intensity passing through a sample which containing a reaction which produce of the original substance and reagent. So principle like Beer-Lambert's law and electromagnetic radiation between the 380 to 780 nanometer. When you, they ask calorimetry, you should write the principle of photometry and laws of photometries like Beer's law and Lambert's law and the electromagnetic radiation. So the calorimetry we can measure only 380 to 780 nanometers. So this is the photocalorimeter you should draw when they ask only calorimeter. So the components are shown are like lamp, that is the light source and slit, and condensing lens, then monochromator like our filters, cuvettes. Here only glass cuvettes are used, and the photocells, that is a photomultiplier tubes here, and the galvanometer, which are readout device. Here in calorimetry, preparation of solution for investigation, we use blank for distilled water and standard of known concentration and test of unknown concentration. Here can so calculation, the concentration test is equal to OD of test minus OD of blank by OD of standard minus OD of blank into concentration standard by the volume of test sample we taken into 100. So what are the applications of calorimeter? So we already know that calorimetry, which is widely used in hospitals and clinical laboratories. So for the estimation of various biochemical compounds and various samples like blood, plasma, CSF, urine and other bodily fluids, and also estimation of various biochemical compounds like glucose, urea, creatinine, uric acids, bilirubins, lipids, total proteins, albumins. So many compounds we can measure using a calorimeters. So enzymes like AST and ALT also we can measure, and minerals, calcium and phosphorus. So AST, ALT here we can measure only in calorimetry by using endpointing methods, not kinetic methods. So kinetic methods we can measure in spectrophotometers. So come to the spectrophotometer. So spectrophotometry, to measure the transmittance or reflectance of visible light along with UV light or infrared light. This is the advantage of spectrophotometer over the calorimeter. So in calorimeter we can measure only visible light, whereas in this UV light and infrared light also we can measure. So that's why instead of filters or monochromator, it is used as a prism or diffraction grating with a slit as a component. So this also based on working on Beetz-Lambert's law. Here components are, this is a diagram you should draw for spectrophotometers. Okay, the light source, lens, here prism or diffraction grating are used, and the slit, sample and the photocells and display, but remaining are same. So spectrophotometers are two types, one single beam or double beam spectrophotometers. Here single beam spectrophotometer, here the same as what we seen before, light source, monochromatic cuvette holders and detectors and meters. Whereas in double beam spectrophotometer, there is a extra reference cuvette we used in order to minimize the error. So double beam spectrophotometer is the more sensitive than single beam spectrophotometers. Okay, this is the diagram you should draw for double beam spectrophotometer. This is the same diagrammatic representation in spectrophotometers. So measures the absorbance by using our function of wavelength. So applications of spectrophotometer. So quantitative analysis and also qualitative analysis. In quantitative analysis, that is estimation of proteins and others, carbohydrates also we can measure, proteins we can measure, albumin, total proteins, bilirubin. So what are the other compounds which can measure in visible calorimetry, we can measure in spectrophotometry also. Along with, we can measure enzyme assays like kinetic assays like LDH, pyruvate kinase, urease enzyme activities, and other physiological studies like determination of reaction rates and detection of functional groups like double bonds, single bonds. Okay, and also can measure the compounds with the characteristic absorption maximum. So the absorption maximum of proteins at 220 nanometer, whereas in nucleic acid 260 nanometer, and NADH, that is 340 nanometer, and porphyrins 400 FAD 450 nanometer, bilirubin 450 and FADH2 570 nanometer. So this is the nanometer, at which nanometer the absorption, maximum absorbance of these compounds. So what are the difference between the calorimeter and spectrophotometer? Light source, that is the here in calorimetry we use tungsten slab, whereas in spectrophotometer deuterium or hydrogen lamps we use. Whereas in electromagnetic spectrum we use visible range, that is 400 to 700 nanometer. Whereas in spectrometer, along with visible range, we can measure UV range, so less than 380 nanometer, and infrared more than 780 nanometer or 750 nanometer. Also, we can measure in spectrophotometer. And the chromatic devices like filters, monochromatic, as a monochromatic colorimeters, whereas in diffraction gratings and prisms are used in spectrophotometer. And absorbance measures concentration of only color substances or color solutions. But in spectrophotometers, we can measure concentration of even colorless solutions by like NADHs and NAD. Whereas cuvettes, here we can use quartz and glass cuvettes. Usually glass cuvettes are used in colorimeter. Whereas in spectrophotometer, only quartz cuvettes only used. So in sensitivity, when compared to spectrophotometry, calorimetry is less sensitivity, and whereas in spectrophotometer is 1000 times more sensitive than the calorimeter. And also cost is low when compared to spectrophotometer, whereas in spectrophotometer it is 10 to 100 times more costlier than the calorimeter. Okay, so usually they ask for these question, they ask for 10 marks question or 5 marks question, like calorimetry they will ask and spectrophotometry. If they ask photometry, you should write along with calorimetry, you should write photometry, spectrophotometry also. Okay, so you should write the principal, instrumentation, working mechanisms and applications and differences, and diagrams also you should draw. Thank you.